Welcome in to a jam-packed edition of Talkin' Beavers as Oregon State heads to the Big House as a 1-0 football team. Bit of a mixed bag for the North, but the Beavers came through unscathed, partly because Seth Collins was difficult to scathe. He rushed for 152 yards, the most since Timmy Alexander back in 1996. Huge challenges ahead, though, as the Beavers head to the Big House. We're talking about it right now. Talkin' Beavers right here. It is the largest stadium in the country, a capacity of 107,601, expecting 111,000 and some change. It's the Big House, and we're in the beautiful house of the Flattail Brewing Studios as we welcome you in to a jam-packed edition, as the man said, of Talkin' Beavers. Mike Parker along with Lindsey Schnell, Slade Norris, and a lot to get to as we'll talk about Harbaugh and Michigan and Harbaugh and a little bit more Harbaugh.
Excellent.
But we certainly have a Beaver football game against Weber State to get to as well, with the Beavers coming through with a solid second half and a victory over Weber State to go back to Ann Arbor 1-0. Lindsey, let me start with you. Just first impressions of Seth Collins, the quarterback. He gets the start. What were your thoughts about his play?
Wow, that kid's got some wheels. Very strange to see an Oregon State quarterback running so much. I was impressed. I think that he has a terrific swagger about him. That's going to be huge as they go into Michigan. And I think it's also something he's going to have to learn how to harness, because he's going to get hurt if he runs like this and continues to hurdle people all season. Right, Slade? We were texting about this during the game, that we were a little worried for his health.
That's exactly what I was thinking. Go take notes from Cam Newton, from RG3. You know, as the competition goes up, these guys are going to get harder, hit harder and harder. And so is it great to see him with 152 yards rushing and 17 carries? Not exactly, but it was working for that game, and so we'll be happy with it.
One of the big things, Mike, is he's got to get down. He's got to slide. And he actually said after the game that when he got back to his locker, he wouldn't be surprised if there were baseball pants hanging there to remind him right. to slide occasionally. So maybe that's something that Gary Anderson could consider doing.
You know, the hurdling in space, that's dazzling. The crowd went crazy. I think it's been viewed a million times or more already by Beaver Nation and others. But it's the not getting down and the actually creating contact with the safety on that one play late in the game. And so we see that he can run. What about throwing the football? Slade, what did you see from just the pure passing standpoint?
You know, there were some good points, some bad points. He stares on his receivers a little bit, but he has some nice touch on his throws at the same time. He's good at creating time in the pocket. I'd like him to not pull it down so quickly for the run, but hey, it was working that game, so why not use it? Next game, I don't think it's going to be as easy, but as you see right there, rolling out, creating open space for Victor Bolden, I was impressed. For a freshman coming into a first game, I liked what I saw.
I mean, he's no Josh Rosen at UCLA, but I thought he did a pretty good job, especially because this is just so, it's so different for everyone.
There can only be one anointed one, the chosen one, whatever the case for Josh Rosen, who did look pretty good. It's time for the Les Schwab quick fix. Les Schwab doing the right thing since 1952. And in terms of quarterback play, certainly helped by a running game, by an offensive line, but also by receivers. And, you know, it was a mixed bag there, too, in that Victor Bolden should have had a touchdown, so the 6 yards for Victor should have been more like 56.
Absolutely. Victor Bolden and Jordan Villeman, they got to step up more, you know, and Storm Woodsy's a really good receiver out of the backfield, but someone else has to emerge. It can't just be those three guys, and I'm interested to see how Bolden fits into this offense, because he was primarily used as a fly sweep guy in the old, under the old regime, so, but Slade, there has to be someone else who emerges.
There does, and I'd like it to be the tight end position.
Okay.
He had no catches, or maybe one catch for no yards.
Dylan Clute, one for one.
Yeah. You got to do more than that. I mean, take notes from Michigan's offense with Mr. Butt. I mean, he had 83 yards right there, a great game. Oregon State has got to get some production somewhere else, and I'd like to see it from there.
You know, they do call him Mr. Butt, by the way. We'll have more on Jake Butt a little bit later in the show. Certainly one of the great weapons for the University of Michigan on offense. In terms of the tight end, Caleb Smith did not have the ball thrown to him. And Slade, is there any part of this, the Beavers, with all due respect to Weber State, that you sit on some things in a game like this and maybe have some other things to roll out in game two?
Most definitely. And you know what? You're going to see a big change, I believe, from how Seth Collins played in the first game to how he plays in the second, and who he hits in the second. He was just going on nerves right there, especially in the first half, and it's all happening so quickly.
Right.
This next
adrenaline game,
things are going to slow down a little bit. He has one under his belt. He had a good game, and so I think we'll see him spread it out a little bit more.
Yeah, certainly you never show the whole playbook, right?
Yeah, and Lindsay, that drive in the third quarter, the first one, 16 plays, 75 yards, I thought was a real glimpse of what this offense is supposed to look like.
Yeah, I thought the offense looked better than I anticipated. It was not smooth by any means, but I think that there are glimpses of what it can be. But, you know, here's the truth. If Seth Collins gets hurt when he takes off, I don't feel great about the backup option, just in the one game that we saw, and in general, in terms of how many backups they have. So he has to stay healthy.
Well, Marcus McMarion was 2 for 4. He made a couple of good passes early, and then the interception, according to his head coach, Gary Anderson, not Marcus's fault. So I suspect we'll see more of Marcus McMarion as we go. But for now, it's Seth Collins' job. Now, at Michigan, Jim Harbaugh had his quarterbacks back. Jake Rudock threw 3 picks. This Michigan Wolverine program is all about the homecoming of Jim. We'll have more on Coach Harbaugh later. But up next, there's an interception by Manase Hunulu, part of a great defensive effort. We'll hear from D coordinator Kalani Sitake as Talkin' Beavers rolls on.
Sets his feet. It's time now. From the backside, the ball is stripped and is loose.
Kind of reminds you of Kalani Sitake defenses, right?
He's a very intense coach at times. I feel like he knows when to be intense and he knows when to chill, and that's what makes him a great coach. If he sees us slacking, he's going to get in our butts, but if he sees us working hard, he's going to pat us on our butts and say good job.
They go. It's going to be fun watching this defense get after it all afternoon long.
It's a little different, you know. He just tell you to come and hit him on the mouth. It's football, you know. There's nothing fancy about it. You know, he said it himself, he's not a guru, but he said if you come and knock people in the mouth, you're going to win.
Kalani Sitake dialing up aggression.
You make sure, you know, you're talking to the linebackers, make sure they do what they're doing, because you know he's behind you. They might not know, so, you know, we don't loaf out here at all. So every practice play, we go 100%, just like on the game day.
I think that we've had a lot of success over fundamentals and just the simple things and trying to get it out of our guys. So I don't know exactly the secret or the formula, but I just know that our guys will play hard and you know, we'll be technique and fundamentally sound.
Kalani Sitake talking about the Beavers and their defensive performance. Of course, he was the coordinator last year with Utah that went back and won in the Big House and harassed the Wolverines in a 26-10 victory. That was the first game, of course, we've all seen a Kalani Sitake defense for Oregon State. Slade, you were a great defensive player for the Beavers. What did you see? Did you like what you saw from the defense?
The biggest change I saw was open field tackling. Oregon State's always struggled from the beginning tackling in space. These guys were flying downhill, being aggressive, but breaking down, sound technique. I loved seeing that. And then all the blitzing. They're sending safeties, sending corners. It was a fun defense to watch.
The fact that they live tackled all spring and into fall camp, we talked about this last week, we thought would make a difference, and it clearly did.
And, you know, Lindsay, too, Kalani, he talked about we have had success. I'm not sure I've seen a more deferential coach than Kalani Sitake. He's talking about, he says, I'm not a guru, or his players say, he said, I'm no guru, but we're going to hit you in the mouth. I don't know how many gurus hit people in the mouth, but Kalani is very humble about his craft.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. He might not be a guru, but I'll tell you what, this guy's going to be a head coach pretty soon. He's a very, very good coach. And, you know, when you talk about Utah, because that's where he was, and they still employ a lot of stuff that he does, what is Utah? Physical. Okay, Utah just beats people up. And we talked last year about Oregon State lacking, they were soft sometimes, and they lacked physicality. And just in one game, I like already what we've seen.
There's some toughness here, isn't there? I mean, you talk about a physical game coming up, we'll talk more about it, but Kalani's already preached it and is getting some results, it seems.
Definitely. As you were saying, last year we critiqued that area, and one player I picked on particular was Larry Scott. And if you go back and watch that last game, there was a play where he beats 2 blockers, knocks the ball out of the wide receiver's hands, completely annihilates him. And that's just a different player from last year. And so he's transforming these guys into the type of players we want at Oregon State.
And Kalani is giving all the credit to his players and to the assistant coaches. But make no mistake, Kalani Sitake, the coordinator of a defense that got off to a tremendous start. Now, a guy that got off to a great start individually was Romo Mangiello, amongst others. And we're going to hear from some of the Beavers players, Romo leading off, about how they performed against Weber State.
We just execute our assignment, you know, stayed on coverage, and especially the D-line, you know, they got their hands up, and they got to the quarterback, and that's what we did good against Weber State. And hopefully what we're going to do again versus Michigan.
I think a lot of credit goes to the coverage. I think we had really good coverage. There's a lot of opportunities. I think there's six of them that were third and five and under, so they weren't all third and long. But our guys were able to play within the scheme and executed their assignments, and I thought the coaches prepared them well, you know, and our guys just made plays, and hopefully if we play within the scheme and we are physical, that's, I think the physical is just part of the game. I don't think we should have to require your guys to do that. I think they just have to do it.
Correctly, you know, everybody played 100%, you know. You know, not every play you could go, you know, you could do your job right, but every play you could give your full 100% effort, and everybody gave that. As you can see, from the linebackers to the DN to the DBs, you know, we're coming up making big hits, corners making big hits, and then, you know, we're all celebrating as a team. You know, we all played with the same mindset. We all played as one, and that's what you want from your defense.
And Justin himself delivered a strong hit on a third down play. Part of the futility that Weber State had in going 0 for 13, Gary Anderson said, that's an amazing stat. Well, it's so amazing, it's number one in the country for opponent third down conversions, with Weber State going 0 for 13. And Justin did deliver a strong hit on the sideline. He paid a little bit of a price with a stinger, he said, but he delivered the blow. We saw Caleb Solo come in on that middle backer blitz and delivering a blow. And these guys, Slade, it's not a coaching effort. They're getting that. Lindsey and Slade both talking about that's not something that they have to coach. They should expect that.
I really liked when Kalani said that being physical is a requirement of football. I think that we would all agree with that, although it's something that this program lacked last year. And so I really like that he said that. His favorite word outside of physical, I believe, is disruptive. And that would be a terrific way to describe the defense against Weber State. And let's be clear about something, okay? Weber State is not a great team. However, the team down the road in Eugene, they gave up quite a bit of offense to another FCS school. So I was even more impressed with Oregon State.
And you know what? Throughout the game, with the show they put on, I mean, only giving up 178 total yards, they missed some opportunities. They had some interceptions dropped. They had some sacks missed. So it really could have been better. And that's the kind of stuff they need to look back and change and take advantage of all these opportunities going forward.
And even in the fourth quarter, once the game was decided, they didn't stop being physical. They didn't stop being disruptive. And I think that we had not seen that from an Oregon State team for a while, like really a true 60-minute effort.
I completely agree.
And Kalani Vaakamalele with a big sack. That was great to watch him play because he was highly recruited out of the state of Hawaii, kind of an under-the-radar guy, but a guy in the end, a big push, and he gets a big push up the middle for a sack.
Oh, it wasn't just one person, though. It was everybody. I mean, that quarterback got hit by so many different players, and these hits weren't just, you know, dragging him and throwing him down. He felt that the next morning, and so that's why this defense throughout the year, you know, they might not be technically sound the entire time, but they are going to be disruptive and they're going to be fun.
Mike, I just want to say that you're doing an excellent job pronouncing all these people's names, and I think you could give pronunciation lessons on campus.
Above my pay grade.
Please don't ask the players if I'm actually doing okay. I'm just kind of bluffing my way through as we get ready to try to get all the names right. And as Slade mentioned, there are many of them, and we're going to be talking more about the Beavers and their performance against Weber State with game balls, Wilson Motors game balls, to be handed out by Lindsey and Slade as Talkin' Beavers rolls on. We'll have more on that man you may have heard a little bit about in this offseason. Now one game in, Jim Harbaugh with his home debut in the Big House. In his alma mater, he beat the Beavers back in 1986 at quarterback, 31-12. We encourage you to check out the CSN Fan Zone. It's a fan rewards program. Go to csnnw.com/fanzone to join. Monthly prizes awarded, which include iTunes gift cards, Amazon gift cards, and some wonderful CSN merchandise. That's the CSN Fan Zone, csnnw.com/fanzone, and you can join up. Well, it's time for Nigel Burton's weekly feature. And I know Nigel, he gave credit and was very proud of what his former team did in going up and defeating Washington State on the Palouse this past weekend. But Nigel had his eyes on what the Beavers were doing against Weber State. And so it's time for this week's Burton Breakdown, brought to you by Standard TV and Appliance.
So Seth Collins got the first start of his college career at Oregon State, played great, especially when it came to running the football. But what I want to do is take a quick look at some of the things they've got to continue to do offensively if they want to have success as the season wears along and they get into Pac-12 play. Let's take a look at the in-focus MondoPad, the new way to collaborate, and see what happened last weekend. Now here against Weber State, what you can see is they did what a lot of teams are going to do against Seth and this Oregon State offense. They load the box, they've got one safety. Now, it's second and seven. They've got one safety at 8 yards, the other safety at 9, and every other member of the Weber State defense is within 9 yards of the football. Now here, they do a great job, in particular the offensive line, creating a great pocket for Seth to be able to step up, be in complete control, not panic, and throw a beautiful deep ball to Jordan Villeman on the sideline. As he steps up, you couldn't place the ball any better. Right over the outside shoulder, the defensive back has no chance. Touchdown, Beavs. If the Beavers want to continue to have this kind of offense success, they've got to make sure that they complete deep balls and make defenses pay for loading the box to take away the run game.
Burton's Breakdown, brought to you by Standard TV and Appliance, setting the standard since 1947. That beautiful deep throw to Jordan Villeman, and there should have been, as we've already talked about, another touchdown added onto it. But nice to see how Nigel broke that down, why that play worked, and Villeman's going to need to make those kind of plays this weekend.
Absolutely. That's what we talked about, right? Someone else has to step up.
And there were some balls dropped there during the game that, I mean, if they catch those, our passing is a little bit more wide open.
You know, there could have been a Burton breakdown on the throw that Victor Bolden, I know, is seeing in his nightmares this week, because that ball was perfectly thrown. And for me, Slade, it was as impressive to see Collins deliver that one on a rope to follow up the throw he had just made to Villeman, even though Victor dropped the ball. That was a beautiful throw.
Oh, completely. To have the faith still in your wide receivers to go deep right again. I loved seeing that, and it just showed, you know, how ready he is to move on to that next level as a quarterback.
Well, on that note, Slade, not to set you up, but it sounds like we're heading in a direction now as we hand out our Wilson Motors game balls. Who do you have, if I can take a wild guess at it? I think I know who you're going to go with for your game ball of the week.
You know, I go with Seth Collins for that. He played a fantastic game, and he wasn't the best quarterback out there, but he was the best overall athlete and playmaker. And you know what? You watch what he's doing right there. Not a lot of people can do that. And do I want to see him run the ball that many times? No. But overall in the game, it was working. He didn't make any huge mistakes. He's going to set the Beavers back. He set himself up great going into this next game against Michigan.
I actually sent a text to Kelly Sullivan, the Oregon State track and field coach, and said maybe you should recruit him to run the hurdles. And he thought it was a good idea. I'm going to take Slade's side and pick a defensive player, Mike. I was really impressed with Rommel Mangiao. Was I close?
Pretty close. Mangiao.
Okay. Mangiao. The point is, he did a great job. He set the tone defensively, obviously led them in tackles. But I just love the energy that he played with. And he was disruptive, as Kalani Sitake would like to say. I thought he was great. And this is someone that we haven't talked about a lot in the preseason. And they need someone to step up. We've talked a lot about who else can emerge, and maybe it can be him.
You know, Romo, as we saw, forced that fumble on the first sack in the Gary Anderson, Kalani Sitake area. And the play that I liked, and you talked about this too, Slade, the play that he made in space there at the end, getting the receiver on that shallow cross and chasing him down and wrapping him up and pulling him down, part of that 0-for-13 third down conversion rate for Weber State, Romo was all over the field.
Technically sound and athletic. I mean, not just him, but all of our linebackers were all over the field, you know, making plays. And that's the kind of defense that Kalani's going to bring to Oregon State. Somebody that's the line is holding up their end of the bargain. They're sitting there getting the double teams, and these linebackers are flying all over making those kind of big hits.
Yeah, I think, and that's they've got to continue, right? You got to build into Michigan, because as bad as Michigan might have looked against Utah, they are a lot better than Weber State. And there's something different when you're playing at home, especially when you're playing at home in the Big House.
And I'm not sure that I would say Michigan was bad at Utah. Utah's very good defensively. Michigan did turn the ball over a little bit three times, but in the second half, they showed a will to run the football, and they were much more effective doing so, and that's the Harbaugh style, as we well know. Now, speaking of Jim Harbaugh in Michigan, you may have heard that Harbaugh's back at Michigan. The Beavers are going to find that out firsthand. They've certainly dealt with Jim before. We'll talk about Harbaugh and the impact in Ann Arbor. The Beavers are getting ready for a different sort of venue, heading back to the legendary Big House. The venue is as impressive and famous as the football tradition itself at Michigan. We're going to learn a little bit more right now, though, about that tradition and what the Beavers, in a sense, are going into this Saturday in Ann Arbor. And we'll hear the voice of the late and legendary Bob Eufer along the way, who once referred to the head coach as Bo George Patton Schembechler. Bob Eufer, Michigan Wolverines football.
When a hush settles over that stadium and we all anxiously wait for that simple four-word command, band, take the field. They pour over the eastern sideline, they form the big block M, and they play the greatest college fight song ever written, the Michigan Victor.
I'm not going to say that I'm nervous or nothing, but it's going to be definitely nice to play in a stadium with so much history.
You know, I'm really excited for that. I can't wait. 100,000+ is going to be something.
You know what I mean. You can feel the excitement that surrounds that stadium every Saturday afternoon.
I used to always watch first game on TV, Michigan versus somebody, you know, in the early morning, midday. So to be able to play there, that's just, it's a dream come true.
For me, it's even more. One of my mentors was part of the Fab Five, went to Michigan, Ray Jackson. So he'll be at that game, and I need bragging rights.
I'm really excited. I've never been to Michigan. 110,000 people would be pretty cool to play in front of, you know what I'm saying? That's going to be an experience. I'm going to take pictures, but I'm just trying to come out there with a W, and I think we will. That's just my plan, go in there and just disrupt stuff.
So the capacity now, 107,601. They're expecting 110,000, 111,000 as we take a look at the Beavers trying to break through in that kind of environment for the first time. Our own Slade Norris was part of that historic trip to Happy Valley and Beaver Stadium back in September of 2008. Slade, what do you remember about that whole experience before that many human beings?
You know, the buildup was fun. After the game wasn't as fun. But growing up, you watch these blue blood programs, you know, these people who, like Larry Scott said, you get up in the morning and the first game's on in the morning. You love watching that when you're growing up. It's exciting to go just see that those historic sites. As far as playing in the game, whether it's, you know, 60,000 or 100,000 people, the noise level, it doesn't really matter. You can't hear anyway. And so 40,000 more people, who cares? What really affected me personally was the time change.
I was wondering about that.
I don't like playing in the morning. I wasn't a morning guy. And so getting up and just getting revved up, and it messes up your routine, because over in the Pac-12, we're used to having all these night games, and now we play first thing in the morning. So that was the biggest change for me.
They are leaving a day earlier, right, in hopes that they'll have that adjustment period. But I agree. I thought about that. Now, let me ask you a question. Though, okay, noise wise doesn't affect you, but when you run out of the tunnel, were you honestly not intimidated, not even a little bit?
It wasn't an intimidation, it was just excitement, because it's like, you know, running out there, there's this many more people we get to disappoint today.
You know, as far as Gary Anderson goes, he used the phrase, loud is loud. So you're right, whether 60 or 100, in certain venues actually are even louder just by the way they're configured. So Gary talked about that in his media availability this week, and also about whether he'd ever crossed paths with that guy named Jim Harbaugh.
A couple players that played for him, and Obviously, he's a very successful coach, and he's at a very, very good place. This game is not about a coach or any coaches, and it never will be, in my opinion. It's always going to be about the players, and if we want to sit back and talk about players, we can talk about players all day long. But I'm sure that their coaching staff really is the same way for the most part. But crossing paths with Coach Harbaugh, I've not crossed paths with him at all.
Well, Gary may never have met Jim Harbaugh, but they're cut from the same cloth. They're defensive-minded coaches. They're physical. They're tough. And I don't know about you guys. I really like Jim Harbaugh, even with some of the things that, you know, the odd things and some of the stuff that he even said when he said, oh, the Beavers teach holding really well after the Beavers beat Andrew Luck a few years ago at Reser Stadium. I still got to like Jim Harbaugh and his spirit. His dad was a coach for Bo Schembechler. Jim was a ball boy. I like the storylines that he's returning home. I think it's good for college football.
Yeah, Mike, I will say that I think if you had to interview him regularly, you probably would not be a huge fan. My first interaction with Harbaugh was after Jaquizz Rodgers ran all over Stanford as his sophomore year, and a reporter, not me, asked him, what did you think of Quiz? And Harbaugh spit into the trash can next to the reporter and said he's really good. And I was like, okay, this guy's a little intimidating. Is it good for college football? Definitely. But I think that people are kind of tempering expectations. We talked about people don't understand how hard it is to win at Utah. A lot of people don't get that. So Michigan is better than people, Utah is better than people realize, and then that Michigan could go in there and do some good stuff. But Slade, they're not a great team by any means.
They're a big physical team. Are they great right now? No, they have a lot of work to do still, especially I think the quarterback position. He made a lot of mistakes that last game that hurt him.
Although, what is Jim Harbaugh good at doing?
Yeah,
developing
exactly.
Quarterbacks.
And I think really his coaching style, coming back from the NFL to college, fits better. He's more of a control guy. And NFL players are going to rebel against that, and you saw that a little bit with the 49ers.
That's a really good point.
And the cycle of players, too, Slade, right? I mean, every 4 years they change, so that maybe the message doesn't wear on people.
Exactly.
You know, whatever the case, Jim Harbaugh's had tremendous success wherever he's coached. In fact, Mike Riley said the job at Stanford was one of the all-time great coaching jobs, and he's trying to do the same thing now at the University of Michigan and rebuilding their great tradition. Coming
up, Stanford could use some of that offense right now.
Well, coming up, we'll talk a little bit about what Harbaugh is doing specifically on the offensive side. His quarterback, you see him comforting Jake Rudock. He of the three picks. Harbaugh said it wasn't the quarterback's fault. We'll talk about the Michigan offense.
I'm looking forward to the game regardless of how many picks he threw. I want to go in there and I want to play well.
What can he do? What did he do? What advantages can you guys take? What are you watching? What do you see from him on film?
You know, he's a young quarterback, but from week one to week two, he'll get a lot better. So I just got to go in there and study their plays and go out there and be focused.
We've seen, you know, for the Michigan quarterback, he gave up the ball a lot. But, you know, just like us, he's watching the film getting better. So, you know, those opportunities he missed last week, he'll probably get this week. So we got to make sure on the back end we're covering, make sure on the front seven we're getting rushed on the quarterback, being forcing havoc on the quarterback, making him throw balls he doesn't want to throw. And hopefully the defense best come up with the ball.
You know, Jake Rudock had obviously a mixed bag in his Michigan debut with two touchdown passes, but three picks. But Coach Harbaugh said really only one of those was on Jake. And Lindsay, you talked to the defenders. There seemed to be a healthy respect for the arm and what this guy is capable of. Utah didn't sack him, and the Michigan O-line did a good job of keeping him upright.
Yeah, absolutely. Although they did apply enough pressure, I think that certainly everyone will tell you, every good defensive player will tell you, right, that when the secondary is having a good day, it's because people are putting pressure up front. I think that there are some great opportunities for the Oregon State secondary to potentially make some big plays. They can't be dropping interceptions, this is, you know, which they did against Weber State. You can't do that in this type of environment. But I also think that what you have to remember about Harbaugh is he's going to have his quarterbacks back. That's, he is a quarterback coach. So even if Rudock didn't do a great job, Harbaugh is not going to roast him publicly. He might be doing that privately behind closed doors, but I mean, I don't think that Rudock's very good, despite what Jim Harbaugh says.
Slade, what was your take on what Rudock's capable of?
I think he has talent. Mentally, he made some mistakes, and he wasn't sacked. But, yeah, he faced a lot of pressure, and that's really what we have to do. this next week. If we get to him early and get him on the ground, hit him a couple of times, he misses some throws, the first thing he's going to think of is what happened last week and how all of a sudden those three picks came and the game got away from him. We've got to remind him of that last game real early.
And more problematic than the picks, I thought, were his missing Jehu Chesson, big number 86, a couple of different times in what would have been touchdowns and changed that game completely. Kalani Sitake, of course, the Beavers' defensive coordinator, has a tremendous amount of respect for the quarterback and the Michigan style as we hear from Kalani about what his defense is up against in the Big House.
The physical part is evident, you know, and they do a great job at controlling the line of scrimmage. And so I think we have a physical group too, but we have to play fast and they have to play within the scheme that we're teaching them. So I think that we'll see how our guys respond. I think our guys are up for the test, and I can't predict what's going to happen. I just know that our guys are tough, and traditionally Oregon State's played Utah pretty tough in years past and been able to hang in the trenches. So hopefully we'll be able to take the toughness that we have from this group and put it on the field in the Big House. I don't think you can sit there and say, okay, this is the one threat on the offense. I think you got to, for us, we got to play assignment sound football. We got to tackle well. We got to be physical, all that stuff. And we had good work today. We went live today and tackled, and you know, just were able to. I think it's for their scheme. You have to do that stuff, and it was a good day.
And we heard from Justin Strong and Larry Scott earlier, part of the secondary that will be charged to deal with these guys. Amara Darbo with 8 catches, Jake Butt with 8 catches, and Grant Perry only 3 catches and had some miscommunication issues with his quarterback, Jake Rudock, that cost him. All 3 interceptions were, in fact, passes intended for Perry. So that's going to be one of the things that Slade, I'm sure, in meetings this week and practices, getting that communication sorted out. I suspect the Rudock to Perry will be a little bit better this weekend.
I agree. I don't expect him to miss as many throws this week as he did last week. But with their offense, they're not trying to trick you. They want run the ball. You know, I don't think they want to throw it nearly as much as they did last week. So they're going to try to run the ball right up front. They're going to hit their tight ends. And they're going to go deep every once in a while. That's Harbaugh's offense.
That's a great point. That makes me think of, you know, my dad has been a basketball coach for 45 years, and he told me one time, look, everyone knows your plays, okay? It's can you execute them? And that's what, and Michigan didn't do that. You're very right. They don't want to put the ball in the air that much. If they do, Oregon State has to take advantage of that. And again, Kalani's talking about let's be physical, let's be physical. I feel like I could run a team meeting at this point. Let's be physical. They have to do that.
And Amara, a lot of Amara's throws that he caught, they were short passes, just right out to the line of scrimmage, and then he made somebody miss and got some yardage on that. So it's not like they were breaking up some huge chunk yards. So I mean, if the way our DBs played last week, they were all over them.
And did
I like
you see,
our odds.
Slade, did you see enough from the rotation up front, enough bodies on the D line to make life difficult in the run game for Michigan?
That's the biggest thing. We have to win the line of scrimmage. Rotating in and out guys, we have a lot of guys that play with Harbaugh. He brings that Stanford mentality of a ton of tight ends, switching up a bunch of different formations. They'll run the same exact run play 8 different ways. So just knowing your assignments, no matter where you're going to have to line up, because when there's like 3 tight ends in the field, it gets confusing as a linebacker.
And I like what Kalani said about they've been live tackling again a lot this week, and he had said before that that's so important with a young group, that you have to have that intensity up, that we shouldn't see a drop-off in that.
Well, thank you, Lindsay and Slade. Thank you for the breakdown. Slade breaking down the Michigan offense, and he also has Beaver Nation fully prepared for the trip to the Big House as Slade visits the OSU Beaver store.
I'm here at the OSU Beaver store on campus. And guys, it's week 2. We're playing Michigan, traveling to the Big House. It's a huge week. Everyone loves to run the Beavers, but especially the kids. We're featuring them this week. We have infant sizes all the way up through youth XL. And guys, picture your little girls in these cheerleader outfits. Very cute. And speaking of cute, we have baby shower ideas if you want that. Come on in, take a look. Let's start with this one, a little OSU Beaver. What mom wouldn't want to get this for her little one? It's gonna get cold this year, so we wanna make sure we're keeping the kids warm so you can actually stay for the whole game. Dress them up in this fleece, they'll be fine. No whining the entire game, just cheering for the Beavs. Also, you gotta keep the heads warm, the hands warm. We've got gloves, we've got hats. Everything you need for the kids is right here at the OSU Beaver store. For the older ones, the spirit jersey. It's a real popular item. The kids seem to love this one. And if you want to dress like me, the 3 for $25 sale right up here on the wall. They got my shirt, other ones just like it. OSU Beaver Store, fans start here.
You know, they were aggressive up front, and the front seven, matter of fact, they were going after them. And I think if you go after them for the front seven, you're going to beat them. You know, they got a really big running back, you know, but it's all football. Once you attack them, they're not going to do nothing.
Romo Mangiello coming off a big game against Weber State, but he knows he's up against a very physical front in Michigan in the Big House. And very dangerous, physical, talented players. And Slade Norris joins me here at the InFocus Mondo Pad to break down the most dangerous Michigan players among many, the top four. Who do you have for us, Slade?
They got a great team. It was hard to just pick four, but I'm going to start up front with a big guy, Chris Wormley. He's a big defensive end, 6'5", 300 pounds, and if Oregon State's going to win this game, it has to be up front, winning the line of scrimmage. He had his best game against Utah last week, 5 tackles, 3 tackles for loss. We've got to put a man on him and prevent him from getting in our backfield and disrupting our plays.
He penetrated often against a pretty good Utah experienced offensive front. Now we've got Butt, we've got Peppers, we've got Davion Smith. Jim Harbaugh set a record for references to the name of Butt in his postgame conference. Does Butt get number 3? Who goes in the third hole there?
You know what? I'm going to go with Harbaugh with that. The great last name, Jake Butt. He really helped out Michigan's quarterback throughout the game. Harbaugh really praised him for understanding coverages, knowing where he is in space. And if you look at that play right there, great hands. He's got guys draped all over him, still comes down with the play. He has 80-something yards receiving. We got to get a linebacker on him at all times.
6'6", 250, and a next-level NFL tight end without question. So we will be invoking the name Jake Butt, I'm sure, a lot, but the Beavers will try to shut him down. We've got Peppers and Smith left. Who goes number 2?
We're going to go with the Hot Peppers, number 2. He is their safety, but is really a defensive utility player. He does everything for them. They've even thought about putting him on a little on offense. He's a great athlete. Came out in 2014, was the number 2 high school recruit coming into Michigan. Only played 2.5 games last year. He was hurt. But they use him a ton in the nickel package and move him all over the field. He blitzed 6 times. We've got to prevent him from making plays. And he's also huge in the return game.
He's an all-time player that they're talking about in comparison to a former Heisman Trophy winner, a guy who did everything in Charles Woodson. Peppers, he was a little amped up at Utah, and the Utes took advantage early of some over-aggressiveness. You wonder if possibly could the Beavers hit some things on him because he's trying to make the big play.
He did. He calmed down in the second half and played a lot better, but in the first, the slot receiver exposed him a little bit. I don't expect it to happen next week, but we hope so.
He's a great player, and as you said, number 2 recruit, and one USA Today had him the National High School Player of the Year, redshirt freshman, dynamic player in Jabril Peppers, so no mystery here. You're worried most about their running game, huh?
Which, looking at the last game, you wouldn't think so, but Davion Smith, he only had 47 rushing yards against Utah, but you know what? They have a great defensive front 7, and he is a tough, physical runner, 228 pounds, and if you watch that game, he fought for every single one of those yards that he got.
You know, he did miss some holes early, but got better in the second half, and certainly Harbaugh wants to pound it and pound it. Is that why we don't see, I mean, the quarterback, Jake Rudock's not on your list?
You know, he really hurt them last week. 3 interceptions, and he missed 4 wide open throws for easy touchdowns. That game could have been a lot different, so that's why I left him off the list this week.
Yeah, but Jim Harbaugh, ever the quarterback's friend, a quarterback himself at Michigan, had Rudock's back and said those INTs weren't really Jake's fault. Well, we talked about a lot of things. We'll have some final thoughts on the Beavers' big trip to the Big House. Well, I've been looking at this place since Bo George Patton Schembechler was taking on whom Bob Buford described as Dr. Strange Hayes, Woody Hayes. So it'll be nice to walk into the Big House for the first time in person. And we've got you covered heading towards the Beavers' trip to Ann Arbor. Talking Beavers, of course, Wednesdays at 7. Inside the Huddle with Gary Anderson, 8 o'clock on Thursdays. Hashtag Beavers Football, our own Slade Norris, 9 o'clock on Friday night. And a special time, CSN Game Day, Saturday morning at 8 o'clock with the Beavers kicking off at 9 in Ann Arbor. For the Beavers, they're about a 2-touchdown underdog in this thing. I understand that. But I think this game's going to be pretty competitive, personally. Slade, for the Beavers to win it, what's one thing or a couple of things they need to do?
Control the line of scrimmage. Simple as that. Michigan is a very physical team, along with Utah. They matched them. They slugged back and forth. Yeah. Utah's running back, Devontae Booker, he's an amazing athlete, and they held him in check for most of the first half, got away from a little bit in the second. But on offense and defense, our line will win this game.
Okay, Mike, the Pac-12 is going for its fourth win in the Big House. Utah has been responsible for the last two of those, and then before that, the Ducks. I think they have to, number one, be physical, and then 1B, if they're down, it's got to be within a touch. They've got to be within a touchdown at halftime, and then I like their odds.
Now, speaking of touchdowns, the Beavers in the four games, are 0-4 against Michigan, have never had a game where they've scored more than one touchdown. So to break that streak, they need to
maybe get two touchdowns might be
the magic number. And it might be Garrett Owens. We haven't even talked about special teams. Owens showed some real reliability in a field position game. That could be huge.
Yeah, I agree. And it was huge for him to get that. Like, no stumbling blocks right. in week one. That's big time. You go into an environment like this, as we know, because the Beavers have played in other places, other rowdy environments where kickers have not been reliable, that's huge. Like, that could absolutely be the difference.
Yeah, I don't like to think that old LSU game, but controlling
I was trying to not say the name.
Going through, don't let the morning game affect you. Don't let the 100,000 people, let it add to the excitement. Just go enjoy themselves and go play the way they just played last week.
You know, I like what Cyril Nolan Lewis had to say during the course of the week getting ready. He said, hey, bring it on. We're excited to go play. And I think, you know, football players have a way of kind of just blocking out the sound. Loud is loud, as Gary Anderson says. It's going to be loud. It's going to be full. It's going to be an event. And we're certainly looking forward to being back here next week to talk about how this big event unfolds. And be sure to join Steve Priest and Gary Anderson later in the week, Slade on Friday. And we hope you'll all be back again next week as we'll talk about this experience in the Big House. The Beavers heading to Ann Arbor to take on Jim Harbaugh and the Michigan Wolverines. We'll be back again next week to talk about it right here.